watching. Thank you. All right, our next speaker is Allen Chlupacek. All right, I got it. Allen's an engineer from Indianapolis and is a stander for his marriage after spousal abandonment, and he will take a moment to adjust that microphone.
Hello, everyone. My name is Allen Chlupacek. I'm from Indianapolis. And before I get started, I just wanted to throw out something there. My brother and his wife, Emily, brother Andy and his wife, Emily, and their two kids, Drew and Kane, just lost a member of their family, a little two-month-old Frank Arthur. And I say, please ask for some prayers. They'd appreciate it, and I would appreciate it as well. Tough time for the family. I'm divorced and abandoned spouse. Yesterday, actually, was my two-year anniversary, which is an anniversary you don't want to remember, but it's a fact. Though I was not a perfect spouse, I was committed to a lifelong marriage and my children. That was a commitment I made with God, my wife, and God in front of hundreds of friends and family. I was married for 13 years. I became concerned when my wife said she was not happy anymore, said we needed to work on our marriage, made herself look more attractive, was constantly on her phone, was not always around. I tried to save my marriage, but was ineffective. I tried Retrovi, faith-based counseling, the love languages, prayer, fasting, talking to the pastor, rationalization, etc. However, my wife said she was unhappy and filed for no-fault divorce. I am a victim of adultery. Adultery is just like a drug, as I read in the book, Surviving an Affair by Dr. Willard Harley. The book was almost a script of my life. Infatuation grips many, but that feeling comes and goes, as many addictions, leaving people empty. My story is very common in a society obsessed with sex and self-gratification. Society enables divorce today. Friends, family, government, entertainment industry, and churches think divorce is a normal part of society. Marriage is like dating. There is no commitment. I have many friends and family that have been married two or more times, and this is supposed to be a lifetime union. Divorce is contagious. Some of my friends' wives and my wife talked to and supported each other and divorced soon after. This resulted in four divorces and almost a fifth that I know. My street, 50% of the homes have been affected by divorce and separation. Support and compassion are common for divorce, even in situations that are rather weak and selfish. I am friends with several divorced dads that wanted to keep their families and marriages together. They were the ones that also suggested counseling and trying to keep together. However, no-fault divorce reared its ugly head into their families as well. Some only get to see their kids every other weekend since their ex-wives moved to distant locations. Currently, there's not much deterrent to divorce. My divorce was all too easy, and my ex-wife was very well coached on how to do it via lawyers, friends, and family. I firmly believe that no-fault divorce is an evil tool in our society. In all honesty, I should have been the one to file for divorce. However, I knew what that meant, less time with my kids. So I suffered to spend time with my kids, and I cherished every moment I had with them. May say just to get over it and move on. However, this stuff really hurts if you believe in marriage and family. It's taken me 5 years to recover from this traumatic event, and I'm still healing. Also, you never know how bad it is until you experience it. The worst part about divorce was my impact on my kids. They were at the ages of 8 and 6 when this all happened. As I look back, they were so young. I told my wife, you're taking my kids away from me. She said she wasn't, but I lost 50% of my time with my kids. I've lost holidays, vacations, weekends, teaching opportunities, etc. My wife did not waste any time in finding a new partner. She met someone and wanted to introduce him to the kids before divorce was even final. She said it just happened. I told her to at least wait until the divorce was final. She told the kids the actual day the divorce was final. My son had a baseball game that day, and I remember the new boyfriend sitting next to my ex-wife and my daughter. It was really difficult for me, and especially for my kids. The kids came up to me after the game, confused and upset. That really bothered me, even though I knew it was coming. My daughter, at times, before the divorce, became scared at night and would sneak into bed with my wife and me. When my ex-wife and her new boyfriend slash fiance moved in together, my daughter stopped doing that with her mom. She told me she couldn't do it anymore. Eventually, she would ask her mom to come into her room. I remember my daughter using the term SMAD a lot, S-M-A-D. She would say that she was sad and mad at the same time. My son was different. When we first separated, he cried, asking me to see him every night. His mom said that couldn't happen. I wanted to see him every night, too. My son called me up the morning of his mom's remarriage. It was 5 months after our divorce was final. He pleaded with me to pick him up and that he didn't want to go to the wedding. I felt so bad for him and really did want to pick him up. However, I knew I couldn't. I told him he had to do the best he could to get through it. I remember telling my son when he was 11 that I was looking into a Catholic annulment and what that meant. He blew up. He told me not to date until he went to college, and it was all too painful. He was still traumatized with his mom's recent remarriage. My daughter recently has told me she misses her mom being back with the family at the old home and has cried a few times. I did keep the house, but there is definitely something missing with their mom gone. I have gone to mediation twice since the divorce. The first time I fought to keep my son in Catholic school, it was recommended that a counselor decide where he should go. He recommended public school for sports and friends. Divorce takes a lot away from your fatherhood in a lot of ways. Many things are decided via counselors, courts, and lawyers. Currently, I'm fighting to keep my daughter in Catholic school and 50% custody with my son. My son has asked his mom if he could stay at her place during the week and my place every other weekend. It has a lot to do with phones and video games, Fortnite. His mom allows it. I really never wanted to have that stuff. It has caused a big wedge between us. The court hearing is in June. These are the things that my kids and I have experienced. With all that has happened to my family and me, I still have hope. My childhood pastor helped me through my divorce. He told me God hates divorce and wanted my marriage to stay together. However, he permitted it with a plan for a greater good. I didn't fully understand that at the time when I was in deep pain. However, as time went on, things did get better. I grew in my faith and became a much better dad. I am much more involved with my church's school, kids' sports, and charities. People entered my life by God's providence. A coworker that was divorced 30 years prior coached me. I met other divorced dads, and we became a support group. I've helped with my diocese divorce ministry to help others recover from divorce. I also have helped friends, family, and coworkers suffering from divorce. I'm here today, hopefully helping others. I'm still imperfect and definitely struggle at times. Two things keep me going. My hope to be in heaven someday with my kids, and gratitude for what I have. I don't get to be with my kids all the time, but I cherish the time I do have with them. I even cherish the days they drive me nuts. I have forgiven my ex-wife through the grace of God. However, it is a work in progress. Divorce never goes away, and there are always the constant reminders. However, I let it go and focus on the things I can control. I also pray for my ex-wife to make it to heaven as well. Hope someday we can turn the ship around on the divorce culture, where marriage is a lifetime commitment between husband, wife, and God with an openness to children. I'm encouraged to see the laity and clergy discuss this topic because it's affected so many people. My hope is someday that we get marriage back to an act of giving ourselves to our spouses and children instead of taking. I'm very honored to be with you all today and work to get this right. God bless and thank you.